So imagine this. I'm walking through an airport getting ready to board a plane for the most exciting trip of my life. I mean, this is something that I've dreamed of my whole life. In fact, this is an image that day as I'm walking through the airport. Got the brown bomber jacket on, the cool Ray-Bans, and I'm getting ready to board this plane. And as I'm getting on the plane and getting ready to get onto the into my seat, yeah, you laugh. I mean, there's a lot of advantages to being my size. Airplanes are definitely not one of them. In fact, I usually do this. I should probably do it again today. What's probably the biggest question that I get when I'm in public, you think, that people ask? How tall am I? So let's get that off the table right now. And Paul Epstein, this is for you. I am 3'45" tall. No math whizzes in here? Okay, so if you got a C in math, I'm 5'21" tall. If you adhere to the metric system, like my friend from Canada, I'm 2 meters, 6 centimeters. Or if you failed math, I'm 6'9". But as I'm getting into this seat, I'm very excited, but I'm also really nervous. I'm excited because I'm boarding this plane to fly over to Europe to play professional basketball. Imagine that, getting paid to do something that I love. I was really nervous because I was going to be 5,000 miles away from my family and friends in a country whose language I didn't even speak, and I really didn't know what to expect as far as basketball. Move forward from that moment, and I'm lying on a cold hardwood basketball floor. And as I laid on that basketball court, I remember the sounds of the fans being very loud to suddenly hush. And I remember people walking around me and whispering and saying some things. And as I laid on that basketball court, I knew at that moment, my life had changed. I knew it was going to change. We'll come back to that story later. But as a result of my book and TV show, I have the honor of sitting down with Hall of Fame, All-Star, World Champion, former professional athletes. Now, whether you're a sports fan or not, did you know that 100% of professional athletes ultimately lose their job? Undeniable fact, at some point, all professional athletes are done. 25% of NFL players are broke within the first year out. Now, let's look at some simple math here. If you look at the 1,696 NFL players, the average salary, $1.9 million, that's $805 million gone. 78% of NFL players are broke within 2 years out. Again, simple math, $2.5 billion gone. NBA is not much better. 60% of NBA players are broke within 5 years out. $1.8 billion gone. And it's not just the money. 80% of professional athletes experience divorce. Again, if you look at the 3,567 current mainstream professional athletes, that means over 2,800 of them end in divorce. From job loss to disaster, but let's hear what some of the athletes have to say about this transition.
You know, I can remember the first time that I stepped on the field. It was at Pitt Stadium, wearing a Steeler jersey. Having grown up in Wisconsin, being a Packer fan, now all of a sudden I was part of that whole group. Crowds were screaming, you got introduced, ran on the field. It was a feeling that I'll never forget all these years later.
Wow, like, suppose I get there one day.
Do you ever think about retiring?
An athlete could play any sport they wanted. Why football?
Football probably chose me.
100% of professional athletes ultimately lose their job. At what point did you know that that transition was going to happen for you, that you were going to be done with pro football?
Well, here I was at year number 15, at 38 years old, and an expiring contract.
And we get the fourth down, I'm looking at this ball go up, and I'm like, oh my gosh, my career ends like this.
Everybody says you should retire on top. You know, you're at the Super Bowl.
But the stakes were high.
But the transition was at the right point in my life.
The 90% pay cut that professional athletes take, how did you handle that? What was that like for you?
You're not a player anymore.
You know, people say, well, you'll know when it's over with. Yeah, no, I don't believe that, because we've been driven as athletes, you know, to believe you can do it, you know, but no one teaches us, even in society, how to retire, how to leave a job.
What advice might you have for anybody that's going through a transition or change in their life?
It all boils down to what feels good in your gut.
I tell guys this all the time. put your plan together, mm-hmm. and then work the plan. Mm-hmm. Don't work somebody else's plan, right? That's one thing about the league. I love the league, but the league is somebody else's brand, mm-hmm. right? You have to create your own brand yourself, and your brand is whatever you feel like doing, whatever your heart is passionate about, chase it.
But we know professional athletes are not the only one to deal with transition. All of us deal with change and transition all the time, personally, professionally, individually, organizationally. I've written multiple books and multiple articles about this topic of change. And one of the things I've learned, as many, is that there's three questions we have to first answer. Now, before I go any further, you're going to hear lots of great speakers over the next couple days. And one of the things that's important is, as we understand this information, the information that Davin shared, the information that Doug shared, some of the others will be sharing as well, is how do we change? How do we adapt what we're learning into our program? Well, if we're going to change, as an individual especially, there's three questions we have to answer. We have to answer these three questions in order to start this change process. The first thing is, why? Why are we changing? What is the purpose of our change? Why are we doing it? Let me tell you why this is so important. Change is hard. Change is difficult. We're leaving a comfort zone. You're leaving a place of familiarity. You're leaving a place that you want to grow, but it's like, I don't want to leave this comfort zone here. And the why is the glue that helps us to continue through that process. Because if we don't know why we're changing, if we don't know specifically why we're changing, it's going to be difficult, because that's the glue that's going to hold us together. Now, we're going through a 30,000 foot level. We're going to go through this quickly. But the why is very important to understand. Why are we changing? The second question is what? What exactly is changing? Are we changing our software program? Are we changing a leader? What is it that's changing exactly? And the more clear, the more we communicate that, the easier it is. The third question we have to answer is, how do we do this? What is this process for doing this? Well, this is where I come in. Because what I've understood from writing my books, working with former pro athletes, working with organizations and other individuals, is that there's a process. Doug talked about a process. There's five things that will help you accelerate through change. This is how you do it. I call it the five rules of change. You'll hear that I like math. You heard my math problem earlier. You'll also hear that I like acronyms. You're also going to learn that I like history. So let's delve into this. The first letter is R, R-U-L-E-S. The first letter is refocus. And what I've discovered is that individuals that go through a refocus, in other words, how do I refocus? Well, I look at my current goals and I establish new goals. It's part of my plan. I make a plan. We've heard Ray Lewis talk about make a plan. This is where making the plan. Now, we can't talk about sports without talking about beer, can we? Personally, I don't drink. That's just my choice, my own personal choice. But boy, back in the early 1900s, there was a lot of drinking going on in America. In fact, at the beginning of the 1900s, there was 1,273 breweries in America. I don't know if you knew that or not. On January 16th, 1920, something happened in America that changed the path of those 1,273 breweries. Anybody know what it was? I don't think anybody was around at that time. What was it, sir? Prohibition. On January 16th, 1920, the 1,273 breweries in America were told, guess what? You can no longer do this. Talk about change. Talk about transition, talk about adversity. That's like playing hockey and snapping your neck. You're suddenly done. So as I did research and looked at this, I said, well, boy, you know, there was 1,273 breweries that were open during Prohibition. And by the time Prohibition was over, 244 remained open. So my question isn't what, well, I knew what happened to the 80% that closed. We know that. But what did those 20% do? Well, one of those breweries decided they weren't going to take this big change lying down. They were going to have a refocus. And they went from brewing beer to brewing malt extract, ginger ale, even car and auto parts. And as a result, Anheuser-Busch not only survived the sudden change, but their refocus helped them. I think they sold for $54 billion or whatever it was some years ago as a result. But let's hear what some of the athletes have to say about their refocus after they were done playing pro sports.
I would say stay the course. Do what you think that will help you out. I mean, you gotta plan for that though, because once basketball is over, mm-hmm. you have to plan for something, because you can't play. I was fortunate enough to play 19 years.
That's amazing.
A lot of guys don't play 19 years, mm-hmm. and then they're finished. They don't know what to do. A lot of people didn't get their degrees and things like that, so they have to find their niche mm-hmm. after that.
So having a refocus is very important. Again, we could spend half a day talking about just this one alone, but that refocus is the very first step when going through a change. The RUL, the next letter U, stands for using your network. All of us have a vast network of people around us. I mentioned the example of Anheuser-Busch earlier. They had a vast distribution network already established from when they were brewing beer. And as a result, they tapped into that distribution network and said, hey, listen, we're no longer brewing beer. We can't, but we have malt extract, we have ginger ale. Can you help us distribute that? And again, tapping into their network, very important to do. All of us have a network of people around us. Now, let me qualify about this. When I talk about using your network, I'm not talking about using and abusing people. Okay, it's like, here's my refocus, here's my goal. Boy, I'm gonna use this person or this group of people to get what I want. No, I'm talking about creating win-win relationships. So as you tap into your network, let's look at that. And here's an example. I mean, this is actual advertisement during that time when Anheuser-Busch was selling and brewing ginger ale as a result. Tapping into the network. All of us have a network. And so as you refocus, looking at who in your network can you tap into to create this win-win relationship. Again, let's hear what some of the athletes have to say about this using their network and how they use their network.
I get a call after year four from a good friend of mine, Pete Scorch, who is down at the Pistons yes. right now. And mm-hmm. he was at the University of Michigan at the time and say, I've got a position and opening up. Why don't you come in and audition for the position?
Work directly with universities. And we actually go through and help get to that point of being able to help them manage and get to that point of commercializing their products. And it's just really exciting because we teamed up with the University of Pittsburgh, we teamed up with Michigan, yes. we teamed up with Columbia. That's just, they're a new partner as well with us. So it's just exciting to really see that different side, but being able to help some of those technologies come to light.
I got a call from Vinny Johnson. Vinny said, what do you think about coming back here and working for me? And I was thought about it. I said, sure, Vinny, I would do that. So I came back here, worked for him at J&M Automotive Transport Company.
Doing what? What kind of things were you doing?
I was in sales in, mm-hmm. in there.
All my ups and downs have been public, and they were there along the way for
supporting you. And
right, which enabled me to get, you know, with a lot of help from a lot of people, get to where I am today.
Mm-hmm. So this last gentleman you see right here, Darren McCarty, four-time Stanley Cup champion, won the Stanley Cup four times, had a very horrific and public transition out of pro sports. Drug addictions, gambling addictions, bankruptcies, divorces. He talked about tapping in his network of his Red Wing family, Detroit Red Wing family, and that was part of his help of finding the help that he needed to move on. And so asking for help, as Doug mentioned, asking for help, tapping into that network as you go through this change. We're gonna delve a little bit deeper into that, but that's the using your network, finding your network, tapping into that network as you're going through this change. The L, R-U-L, bar none, without question, no argument whatsoever, is the most difficult for professional athletes. Letting go. Letting go. Because it's in the marrow of our bones to never give up. Fall down seven, get up eight. Right? And it's very difficult. Let me give you a great example. I had the honor of sitting down with an executive from the Ford Motor Company. Anybody ever hear of the Ford Motor Company at all? Right? So I had the honor of sitting down with the Ford Motor Company executive, and I asked him, I said, you know, this 2008 thing that happened, the economic downturn in 2008, right? Some of the other car companies were taking government money, Ford didn't. And I said, how did you guys do this? What did you do? And he says, well, he says, there was a list of things we did, but one of the things we had to do was we had to let go of something. And I'm like, oh, what was it you had to let go of? And those of us that were around at that time remember that Ford used to spend millions of dollars on a marketing campaign called Quality is Job One. Anybody remember that? I mean, Ford everywhere is like, quality is job one. You saw it everywhere. They were spending millions, if not tens of millions of dollars on marketing, telling people quality is job one. He said, we realized that we weren't doing it. We had to let that go. We weren't creating quality. And as they started changing product lines and improving the quality, they realized, wow, okay, we had to let go of that because we're not doing it. And now that we are, they're turning billion-dollar profits every quarter now as a result. But let's hear how some of the athletes let go, because again, this is a very difficult thing for the athletes when they transition out.
No one teaches us, even in society, how to retire, how to leave a job. So in sports, you leave either because you're not good enough and you get cut, or you get traded, and or you get injured, or you decide, but how do you make that decision?
Schedule yeah. is what they control. And then all of a sudden, because I was so close, you're kind of putting yourself like, oh, it's time to start OTA practice. It's time to report to training camp. Wait a minute. No, it's not. You're not a player anymore. You know, so yeah. it was tough to get out of that.
Emotionally, it's like a death. You know, you are, You know, you've been playing this game so long, you have teammates, you have, I mean, it's your lifestyle, it's your life. You know, you get lost into, you know, the person and the basketball player. And when you have to cut it off, seem like overnight, mm-hmm. it's tough to do. You know, it's like parting with one of your limbs.
This gentleman right here, he was one of the best players in Cuba. He was on a national team in Cuba, one of the best baseball players in Cuba. In the year 1980, he decided to come on a flotilla of 1,000 people from Cuba over to America. Left his family, let go of his family, let go of his title. And in 1984, he won a World Series championship 4 years later. But listen to what he has to say about his transition out of pro sports.
Very hard. It's very hard when you know when you play for so many years and you play the, you know, you live the life you really dream of to live, mm-hmm. like baseball or play professional at the higher level. You know, when it's time to quit, it's very difficult.
But it's not just professional athletes. All of us deal with that transition. And one of the things I often say is, you know, I like history, I mentioned. And if you look at the Roman generals back in the time of the Roman Empire, when they came home from their conquering lands, whether it be Alexandria or whatever, they had these big campaigns. They were called campaigns, or like a Super Bowl parade is what they were. And as they went through and got all this accolades through Rome, and boy, you just came back from conquering Alexandria or whatever, they had somebody on that general's chariot chirping in his ear the whole time. And you know what they said? It's written in history. You can read this. All glory is fleeting. All glory is fleeting. In other words, so what? What's next? How does that apply to us? Well, all of us have things that we have to let go of in order to move on. Sometimes it's championships we have to let go to move on. Sometimes it's a win. Boy, you know, we were employer of the year, or, you know, we have to let go of that and continue to move on as we continue to change. Sometimes it's negative thinking. It's a thought process we have to let go of. Each of us have to decide and know what that is exactly we have to let go of. The next letter, R-U-L-E, is called execute the plan. This is where you have your plan. This is your refocus. This is where the grit comes in. Because rarely is change, as I mentioned earlier, change is difficult. Rarely is change one and done. Now, what do you notice about this image? Anybody know what that is? I think most of us would recognize what that is. What is that? It's a water pump. How does that work? How does this water pump work? You got to pump it. What else do you have to do with it sometimes? You got to prime it. Sometimes you got to put some water in, then you pump it. Sometimes you put water in, you pump it, you get water right away. Other times you might have to put water in it and pump it again, then put some water in it and pump it again. And it's that way with the change process. Sometimes it's, boy, I pumped it once and I got this change that we've been looking for as an individual or a group. Sometimes I have to keep pumping it and keep changing. I like using this model. It's called a PDCA process. It's called plan, do, check, and adjust. And what it is I plan, which is your refocus. I do it, I check the results, and this is what determines the haves from the have-nots, the winners from the losers. I adjust and do it again. It's that way with the change process. As you're going through your change, it's important to say, okay, boy, you know, this worked or this didn't work. I have to adjust and do some things. So executing the plan is very important. Let's hear what some of the athletes have to say about this execution.
People see the end result, and that's me as a professional football player, but they don't necessarily know the journey that it took to get there. So it's important for me to share that with them to let them know the importance of hard work.
There's many athletes out there, I'm sure you saw them also, that were more talented, but they did not work to get to where they should be. And I saw guys who were not as athletic who worked super hard and became real good athletes.
The main thing is to stay positive and try to find something that you like to do after you retire. Stick with it and good things will happen.
Well, my first advice would be, I know it's tough emotionally with the change. Mm-hmm. I would say reflect on that, but don't get stuck on that.
What do you mean by that? Don't get stuck on it.
Don't get stuck on what was, because you know, the world is moving
forward. The
glory
days, right?
The glory days, because everyone is moving forward with mm-hmm. with or without you. So you can't get stuck on it.
If you have an idea in your mind that you want to do, stick to it. Don't let nobody try to detour you. Have you think of trying to do something else with that mind? It's constantly in your mind already to do it. Try to go out and try to tackle it and see what you come up, what comes out of that.
You have to prepare for that. And you know, I had a little low period because I had an agent that was kind of crooked, and he kind of stole some money from me and mm-hmm. put me in some bad investments. But mm-hmm. I overcame that, and you know, just keep it moving. That's all you can do.
Well, you're gonna have bumps. You're gonna run through bumps, just like bump stops. But you got to keep going and keep going and keep going. Then eventually, something gonna open up. You can't never give up.
So what can we learn from that? It takes grit. It takes challenge, right? It's not easy. Change is not easy. But staying with it, executing the plan, you make your plan and continue with that execution of that plan is very important. The last letter, RULS, stands for someone. What that means is all organizations, all individuals that go through a change have someone, a mentor, so to speak. I mentioned about Ford Motor Company earlier, and one of the executives that I talked to said, we had to let go of this. He also said, when we're going through this downturn, economic downturn in 2008, we actually tapped into a mentor that used to actually work at Ford, then went to Chrysler in the 80s and helped them get through some economic downturn. And as a result, Ford Motor Company tapped into Lee Iacocca as a mentor during this downturn in 2008 to say, boy, you know, you've been through this, help us through this. But let's hear what some of the athletes talk about as they went through their changes and who their mentors were as a result.
I mean, it's just a great experience. When you come into the league and you have Kareem as your mentor, and then your last year you have Michael Jordan as your mentor, mm-hmm. and then you meet all these great guys in between.
Find people who are successful, and let them kind of, mentor you. I've learned that mentors don't always have to be someone older. They can be someone your age or younger. But just find someone who is smarter than you and more successful than you and learn from them.
So having a mentor through this change process, having one person in particular, I want to finish up back to my story where we left off. I was angry on my parents' couch following knee surgery. Here I was, prime of my life, playing pro basketball, living it up, thinking, boy, this is great, this is going to go on for a long time, but it was over. And I was angry. And I remember laying there just being, how could this happen to me? Why did this happen to me? And I remember thinking, boy, at some point I got tired of feeling that way. I got tired of being angry. I got tired of being down. I said, I need to do something productive with my life. So I took a year off, but partway through that year, I decided to go to graduate school, start working on a master's. Finished up a master's in counseling. And I became a counselor. So I started counseling people, mostly kids. And as a result, I'll never forget this. There was one day that I had a 10-year-old girl in my office, and she always dressed pretty sharp, and she came in that day, and I could tell something was off with her, that her hair wasn't quite the way it usually is, and the way she was dressed just wasn't quite the same. And this 10-year-old girl came in, and sure enough, I was asking her some questions, and come to find out, she was really down. In fact, she had talked about taking her own life at 10 years old. So at 10 years old, you have to breach confidentiality. I got the parent in there, and I started asking more clarifying questions of this girl with the parent there. And there was one question I asked her that literally has changed my life since. I asked this 10-year-old girl who she had a plan, she knew exactly how she was going to do it, she knew exactly where she was going to do it, she knew exactly when she was going to do it. And I asked this 10-year-old girl in front of the mother, I said, help me understand at 10 years old, what caused you to think that this is what you wanted to do? She looked at me and she said, I didn't think I had any other options. I had no other options. Well, you can bet that I gave her numerous other options and her mother that day, and she's doing very well today, I'm happy to hear and happy to say. But my reason for bringing up that story is we all provide options to people. Every single one of you, every single day, provide options to people. It doesn't have to be as grandiose as saving a 10-year-old girl, but every day you come up, you show up, and you have options that you provide people. Don't ever take that for granted. So as you go through change, as you hear the wonderful speakers over the next couple days and learn how to change and know how to change, don't forget the fact that what you're providing for people are many options. So I invite you to connect with Doug and I. I appreciate Doug. I invite you to connect. This is our LinkedIn profile. We invite you to connect with us. We'd love to connect with you and see if there's anything we can do to help. But I appreciate your time. Appreciate you. Enjoy the next couple days.
So was it difficult to sit on the sideline broadcast and watch these guys play?
It was difficult, Kurt, the first 2 or 3 years, and here's the reason why. I thought I could still play.
Live in the past, present, and future through the eyes of some of the greatest athletes each sport has known from glory days.
How you doing, Horn?
What are you doing? Have you been interviewed?
Look at this guy, Rick Moore. Hey, where was this when you were on the show?
You get that you got on TV? That?